the term some people will understand this week, let's not just stand there and take a pitch. Let's swing for the fences and beat this virus. We know there are going to be a lot of questions about this and where we're going to, what we're going to talk about, what it means, and really what it doesn't mean also. So to get started, I'll call up Supervisor Nathan Fletcher.
Thank you, Chairman Cox. As was just mentioned yesterday, we came off the state monitoring list, but we just want to continue to reiterate that this is something that is a region we should be proud of and that we got our case count down and below, but the goal is to keep it down and to keep it below. And this is not a finish line we've crossed, it's merely a waypoint in the marathon around coronavirus. And so now is the time as a community that we continue to do the things that we did to get our case count down and to keep them down, to make sure that again, we don't want to go back on the state monitoring list. We want to stay off of it. We want to work with the state. The governor today alluded to the fact that the guidance around indoor operations that were closed, the guidance will be shared and solicited with our public health officers over the course of the weekend to get feedback and input. And next week, we should expect some framework around what that would look like. That does not mean that next week everything will reopen, but we are working with the state to get the guidance. But again, we have to be mindful that we had a very significant spike in our cases. We took action and the cases came down. And so as we move forward, we want to be mindful that we don't want to undo the progress we've made. And we want to make sure that as we move into the next phase of where we go, that we do it cautiously, we do it responsibly, and that we keep our case count down. Today is also on the countdown to the 14 days that we will need of case counts below the state threshold to give our schools the flexibility to consider what configuration or option of instruction that they would like to pursue moving forward. But again, we have to keep those numbers down, and we have to be down for 14 consecutive days. And so we will continue to monitor and work with all of those issues. Let's jump into our numbers today. 7-day average of testing, we're reporting 7,798. Again, well in excess of more than 1,000 over our daily goal. Percentage of positive continues to come down. This is very encouraging as well. And we are rapidly approaching. Tomorrow we should surpass 750,000 total tests reported in San Diego County. Case investigations initiated within 24 hours is at 96%. Number of close contacts traced within 24 hours at 90%. That's good. And we're approaching 40,000 total investigations performed. You can see the treatment numbers there on the right-hand side. On Monday, we got some questions about the turnaround time on testing, and some numbers were shared, and we wanted to graphically represent that for you here. Just to put in context, on an average, what we're looking at here, this is an average reported over a 7-day period. This is from the 9th to the 15th. And there you can see the breakdown, with the hospitals continuing to do the bulk of the regional testing, 3,635 in that 7-day period on an average. It's a daily average. Over 7 days, with a turnaround time between 1 and 1.5 days. You see the county public health lab right below that, 829 daily average with a turnaround between 1 and 2 days. The county with our Helix partnership doing just over 1,200 tests a day, again with a turnaround between 1 and 1.5 days. The state walk-in test that had been a problem before some time ago, I believe back in July, the state changed vendors to try and expedite the speed. They're now turning around their test between 3 and 4 days. Ideally is where the hospitals and the county labs are, between 1 and 1.5 days, but they're between 3 and 4 days. You see our federally qualified health clinics there turning around their tests in 2 to 3 days. And then the commercial labs continue to have significant delays between 7 and 10 days. That's why as a county we don't rely on those commercial labs. We have our partnership with Helix and what we do internal to ourselves. But again, there you can see all of the various inputs that come into our testing system, a breakdown of roughly what they average on a daily basis. So you can see the percentage of the total along with the average turnaround time as we're monitoring. And I think we will probably update this about once a week and continue to share this with you moving forward. On to the next slide today, we're reporting 214 positive tests out of 6,781, 3% percentage of positive. Again, the percentage of positive continues to trend in the right direction, which is encouraging. For hospitalization, we're looking at 104 COVID-related ICUs, 303 total hospital-related hospitalizations, up a little bit from yesterday. Again, these numbers will fluctuate day to day. It's general trends over time, and we're still trending down. Total hospitalizations, you take the 303 for COVID, add in the non-COVID related, and you can see our total regional hospitalization at 4,478. Again, below that 80% bed capacity, which we use as one of our metrics and triggers. And then final chart here is our ICU numbers, again, holding very stable. 104 COVID related in our ICUs, 354 non-COVID in our ICUs for a total of 458, which puts us at 65% ICU occupancy. That concludes my report. I'll now turn it over to Dr. Wooten for her public health officer's update.
Thank you, Supervisor Fletcher, and welcome everyone to today's briefing. Our global, national, and state statistics are based on data that we retrieve daily from the Johns Hopkins dashboard, and this information was obtained today at noon. Our local statistics for San Diego County is generated through reports that come into our epidemiology program, and we report every day for data that has come in by 11:59 on the previous day. Today, there is a total of 35,376 cases, which is 214 more cases than reported yesterday, and this is a slight increase in new cases since yesterday's report of 202 cases. The overall total number of cases includes 638 deaths. 5 new deaths were reported since yesterday. The age range is unchanged at 3 months to 102 years of age. The age group from 20 to 49 years of age remains at 59% of the entire total, and that is 20,805 cases. The for gender, 51% of our total number of cases are female, 49% are male, and there's still 108 individuals where there is no gender information provided. And also, 2,916, or 8% of the cases, have been hospitalized. And of that hospitalized number, 723 have been admitted to the ICU. This represents 2% of the total number of cases and 25% of the total number of those hospitalized. The next slide reviews COVID-19 demographics related to hospitalizations. Of the 2,916 hospitalizations, the age group 50 years of age and older, it makes up the predominant number of cases at 2,068, or 71%. And males represent the majority at 54%, 1,580. Hispanics and Latinos represent the majority at 62%, which is 1,676. In our next slide, going further on reviewing our deaths, the total number is 638. This represents 1.8% of the total number of cases and is also our county's case fatality ratio. Of the deaths, 275, or 43%, are female, 363, or 57%, are male. 611, or 96% of all those who have died, had underlying medical conditions. 27, or 4%, did not. And as always, the county wishes to extend its condolences and sympathies to the family and friends of those individuals who have lost their lives to COVID-19. Now, next, I would like to bring attention to the summary of all of our outbreaks. Since the beginning of the pandemic, we have had 362 total outbreaks in three categories. The first is skilled nursing facilities, the second, other congregate settings, and the third is community settings. Community settings is one of our county's 13 triggers and is elevated, and we will review that in detail shortly. Of the 362 outbreaks, 239, or 66%, are now closed and deemed to be inactive outbreaks, meaning there have been no new cases in these settings in the past 14 days or longer. This leaves 123, or 34%, which is about a third of the 362 outbreaks that are active, remaining active outbreaks. Of these 123 active outbreaks, 34 or 38% are in our skilled nursing facilities, and we have 86 skilled nursing facilities throughout the county of San Diego. In total, there have been 788 residents and 515 staff members with the laboratory confirmed COVID-19, and this includes 153 deaths. 32 or 26% of the 123 active outbreaks are in non-skilled nursing facilities or other congregate settings. In this category, there have been 717 residents, 564 staff members, and includes 101 deaths. Lastly, 57 or 46% of the 123 active outbreaks are in our community setting locations. The next slide shows all active and inactive community setting outbreaks since March 25th, and this is by month. Note that July has the largest number of outbreaks with 93 outbreaks of the 204 community outbreaks. And keep in mind, only 57 of the 204 community outbreaks are still active. This slide shows all 204 outbreaks by community setting. That will be the next slide, and represent 1,460 cases. The top three settings, as you can see on this slide, include restaurants and restaurants/bars, which is the largest number, then 51 in various businesses and 19 in healthcare. And since March, the total number, again, of cases related to these outbreaks includes 1,460, and this includes 12 deaths. Moving on, let's review the 13 triggers for San Diego County. These triggers help to determine what actions will be taken by the county and help us to modify our health office's orders as needed. Trigger number one, which is case rate. We've had a lot of attention drawn to that over the past several weeks. We came off the monitoring list, the state's monitoring list. We had 3 days, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday. We were off yesterday. Yesterday began the countdown for the next 14 days where schools K through 12 could reopen if they wished to do so. So we are now in day two for the 14 days. I would just like to extend a heartfelt thank you to everyone who has contributed to moving us from three abnormal triggers on our trigger dashboard to now we are just at one. And we are at a lowest point for community outbreaks in the past 7 days that we've seen over the past several weeks. So thank you to everyone. So for trigger two, again, this is outbreaks reported over the past 7 days. And today we are reporting 15 total community outbreaks for the past 7 days, and this represents 64 cases. The 7-day average has decreased in the past few days, even weeks. Today, in the next slide, this is just our overall for the last 7 days you see on the right side. That represents our 15 outbreaks. And in the next slide, it shows the most current or new community outbreaks, and there are two that were reported today, one in a business and one in a restaurant only. In the next slide, overall, there's another slide that's missing, but this is, if you can go back, one more, this one. This slide is shows the 15 outbreaks in the various settings, and you can see here that we have 6 in businesses, 2 in food processing facilities, 2 in grocery/retail locations, 2 in restaurants only, 2 in restaurants/bars, and 1 in a healthcare facility. So I just wanted to, moving on to the next slide, just wanted to remind everyone that the county issued, next slide, a KHAN alert on Monday to update healthcare providers about testing priorities. And recognizing the challenges that presented our healthcare systems needing to operationalize testing efforts, in particular, those who face limits in their testing supplies or capacity. We work with our local healthcare partners throughout the region to revise our guidelines. And we ended up on five testing priority tiers, two with the specific priority testing for those groups and individuals with symptoms for COVID-19, and two groups related to asymptomatic groups, two tiers related to asymptomatic groups for groups and individuals, and the fifth tier was reserved for public health surveillance, and that is specified here. Again, tier one, high-risk symptomatic individuals and public health investigations, particularly related to outbreaks. Tier two, other symptomatic individuals in hospitals and procedure testing. Tier three, asymptomatic individuals from high-risk settings and close contacts. And tier four, asymptomatic high-risk individuals. And last, again, tier five, public health surveillance. Now, to give you a preview for next week's briefing, we will be unveiling an update on the county website regarding COVID-19 by race and ethnicity, all in one location. So currently, there is data. There is data information related to cases, hospitalizations, and deaths, all in one location. And then on Monday, we will share testing, staffing, and geographic data by race and ethnicity. Lastly, in closing, I want to reinforce that every and each one of us has a role in our regional success to get through this pandemic. And I'd just again like to thank all of you for what you have done to get us to where we are today. It is great to see the innovative and proactive ways that our businesses have responded to the state's orders. Keeping up the momentum will necessitate that all of us follow these strategies that are outlined here in this slide. This includes washing your hands and promoting frequent sanitation practices, staying 6 feet apart from others, wearing a face covering, avoiding crowds, and lastly, staying home if you are sick. Now, please welcome back to the podium Chairman Greg Cox. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Wooten. We'll go directly to the questions.
Brandon Lewis, CBS 8.
Yes, the governor today discussed some of the ongoing calls between CDPH and county health officials, and he said that while the state has traditionally used a 14-day look back, they're hearing from some county and UC epidemiologists that a 21-day look back may be more beneficial as we prepare for industry reopening. So I'm wondering if the county epidemiologists could give us their opinion on whether a 21-day window might be more appropriate to avoid that seesaw of reopenings and closings that everyone wants to avoid.
Okay, Dr. Wooten's going to respond.
Thank you for the question. And the 21-day going forward and before any actions or additional actions are taken is certainly reasonable. As you recall, in June, when businesses first opened up, that was the guidance that we received from the state. So as the governor stated yesterday, CDPH, California Department of Public Health, will be working with local health departments to figure out what guidance will be issued over the next several weeks. They have not landed on a specific strategy as of yet, and we will continue to work with the state to determine what we land on as that is related to what businesses open up. Thank you.
Thank you. Could you just expand just quickly on, you said the actions are reasonable for the 21 days, just why that was based on what you saw in June?
Well, the incubation period, when we show our epi curve, we state that in that last 14 days, we know that more cases will occur. So that helps us to wrap our arms around how many more cases actually will occur. But you need to have that 14 days and then an extra week to do the analysis to look at where we are. So 3 weeks is a reasonable time period to assess and look back what's happened, where we are now.
Thank you very much.
Okay, next question.
Hunter Sowers, KUSI.
Hi, yes, thank you for taking my question again. Chairman Cox mentioned at the beginning that over the weekend, this weekend, health officials are going to be working with state health leaders, forming those plans, giving input on the reopening of businesses. I know that we don't obviously have any specifics, but I'm wondering if somebody could kind of give us insight into whether these plans will be more tailored to our region specifically, rather than what we've seen previously being kind of more of a statewide basis. If we could just get insight there on what those conversations are looking like right now.
Okay, Dr. Wooten's going to respond.
Thank you again for the question. I think I just answered that with the first question. We had a meeting with the California Department of Public Health last night. When I say we, health officers, in collaboration with leadership at CDPH. Again, there is no specific guidance that has been yet determined. There is dialogue about what types of metrics, and also there will be continuing dialogue about the process. But I have nothing to share with you at this point in time. Thank you.
Dr. Wood, will you be specifically involved in this as it pertains to San Diego obviously representing us, but will you be able to give feedback in terms of what you feel is appropriate for our county?
As I just stated, I was on a call with the state last night as the health officer of San Diego County, and health officers across the state have the opportunity to provide and give feedback based on a request from CDPH. So as health officer, that's my role, and we will continue to do that.
Is there something specific that you are hoping for in these conversations in terms of getting clarity for these businesses?
You know, when we have the sector calls, I keep telling people you can ask the question 100 different ways and I'll give you the same answer. I don't have any additional information for you right now because there has not been any specific strategy or metrics that the state has landed all on. They are right now gathering feedback from the health officers across the state, and that's where we are. So we had a meeting last night to give feedback to metrics. There was discussion about that, but there is nothing that's definitive. We are now with the health officers in a discussion mode. So there are no specific guidance that is yet available that will be released to the general public. When we get that information, you will know it, and actually the governor will release it in his briefings, and then we will also share it here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, next question.
Taryn Mento, KPBS.
Yeah, hi, thank you. I just wanted to ask about the waivers for the elementary schools. I see that 7 are on the website. Are those the first 7 that have been approved? And are we expecting more to come this week?
Okay, Dr. Wooten's going to respond.
So thank you again for the opportunity to share information about the waivers. The state has, in their guidance, stated that when we submit the names of schools for consultation for the elementary waivers, if we don't hear from them in 3 days, then we can approve. I don't send anything up to the state unless we are in. Unless I agree that it should be approved. So we sent that list last Friday. They don't operate on the weekends. It's a 3-day working week. Today was that third day, and so we posted those names, and we will have additional names 3 days after Monday that we will post. So as we submit, and if 3 days transpires and we don't hear back from the state, then we will post those names. So right now,
thank you.
Every day you see the list of those applications that have been submitted, and now you will begin to see by the date of approval those applications that are recommended for approval. Thank you.
Thanks. And just my second question is, I've heard you respond to the other reporters that you don't yet have any information on state guidance, but at the same time, our county, looking at our own metrics, are you and others at the county reevaluating our current metrics for how to maintain a lower case rate moving forward after we implement these reopening guidelines that we're waiting for?
So what dictates having a case rate below 100 is those, if you can pull that slide up, the very last slide that it is not about what the county can do. Certainly we can promote these efforts, but it's about what everyone can do, what individuals can do, what businesses can do, organizations and governments. And these are the actions, because there is no treatment or vaccine, this is really what we have to help wrap our arms around and prevent the spread of COVID-19. And again, over the past, since July 15th, which is when the last health officers, the state's health officers order went into effect, San Diego residents have done a phenomenal job in helping to push our case rates below 100. So we have to continue to do that. That cannot just be a one-time practice. It has to be a continuation and a way of everyday operations to ensure that until there is a vaccine available, that we keep our community safe and that we keep our numbers low. And you saw the triggers. That's what we use to monitor the status of our effort. And as you can see, we went from 3 abnormal to now just 1, which is the community outbreaks. And the number of community outbreaks is also decreasing. So we just need to keep up what we're doing and continue this effort. Thank you.
I should have phrased my question differently. Are we planning any changes to our metrics for monitoring after we reopen the second time?
In the answer to the other two questions before you, the state is looking at different metrics as they explore reopening strategies. Right now, we are very happy with the metrics that we have. So we will continue those, and if there are additional metrics that will be imposed on us by the state or given to us by the state, we will utilize those as well.
Thank you.
Okay, we have one final call-in question.
Paul Sisson, San Diego Union Tribune.
Hello. My question has to do with community outbreak locations. We in the media, we receive constant calls from the public asking us for the specific location of the latest community outbreaks that the county announces. We have been for months telling them the same thing. The county is not releasing those locations. They feel like it would be better for their contact tracing investigations. People would trust them more if they didn't think that the locations were going to be shared, et cetera, and so forth. Lately, I've gotten some questions from folks who note that Los Angeles County does list the locations of outbreaks for workplaces, food and retail stores, and educational settings. How would you guys respond to this question? How is it okay for LA to release this information with specific locations, and it's not okay for San Diego? Here, I can look on this list. I've got enough on my screen right now. I can tell you that there are 383 locations listed in LA, for a total of 4,578 confirmed positive staff. It's alphabetized. Here, the last one on the list is something called Ushuaia in Culver City at 5495 Sepulveda Boulevard, Suite H. So how come we can't get that level of detail here? We can get it in LA.
Dr. Wooten is going to respond.
Thank you, Paul. It's a great question. LA does not have the capacity to do the investigations the way that we do them. And if you call any other health department in some outbreak, if there was additional information that the public would need to take actions. And that's why we release press releases related to outbreaks and other situations in the past. If we have situations in schools, If there are other entities that are we are not aware of or can't communicate, or even in businesses, we would release the information. But there is, at this point in time, not the need to do so, because there is no action that the public needs to take other than that information that I share with you every day. We also have sent out letters to our employers, across the county for various businesses, and that has been a tremendous support and help to our contact, our case investigations and contact tracing. But at this point, just to put the names of the outbreak locations on the website, there is no action that the general public additionally would need to take. That's why we release information when there is an action that an individual or the public could or should take in order to help us identify others that have been exposed that may not know it.
And Dr. Wooten, you know, what I hear from the public is, I have a right to know this. I have a right to use information to direct where I go, if I want to go get some takeout, or if I want to go buy some groceries, or if my kid is going to school. And especially now that we have some universities locally opening up and thousands of kids coming in from all over the country, we're starting to hear from some parents who want to get a good sense of whether the campus that their kid has returned to has active outbreaks going on. And they're a little surprised to see that they can't really discern that from the county information. So how do you balance that in terms of just the public's desire to know and feeling like that, you know, that they need to advocate for themselves in this environment where this we have an invisible disease that's spreading among us?
So Paul, I know you're asking San Diego, but if again, no other county does this but LA. And number two, the virus is widespread, so people should not get false complacency. Assume that the virus is widespread and practice all of those strategies that I share with you every day. That's what people have to do. Assume that everyone has COVID-19. So that's my advice, not only to parents that are sending their kids from out of state. That's my advice for everyone throughout the San Diego County and throughout the state and throughout the nation.
And just to make sure I understood what you said before, your sense of why Los Angeles is publishing this information is that they don't have the capacity to investigate every positive test? Is that correct?
They don't. Well, I would encourage you to talk to the health officer, Dr. Montu Davis, in the Los Angeles County. But that is one of the reasons that they post all of those results.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That completes the call-in questions. We have a few texted questions. The first one happens to deal with contact tracing, and Supervisor Fletcher is going to respond.
Okay, this first question is from Jill Castellano from iNewsSource. She says, it's my understanding that the county contact tracers try to reach out to every person who tests positive for COVID-19 and then follow up with their close contacts. However, we spoke with a family that said they were never contacted by the county when their dad tested positive for COVID. They insist nobody from the county called the dad or anyone in the family. Why might this be? Does the county not have enough contact tracers to reach out to everyone testing positive?
Thank you. Thank you for the question. The aim is certainly to reach out and contact every positive case that comes into our system. We're at close to 40,000 case investigations that have been initiated. And we have enough staffing, as you can see in our daily reports. We're reaching contact with 96% of the new ones within 24 hours. Without knowing the specifics of this individual person, it'd be hard to speculate. There are a number of reasons they could have not been contacted. They could have been bad contact information, a phone number that was transposed wrong on the form. It could have been that somebody reached out and the message didn't get conveyed or relayed if a message was left. It could be the type of test. If they had an antibody test, we only contact trace and case investigate PCR diagnostic testing. It could possibly be we've seen delays in, in reporting on the state system where someone might have been contacted, but the county might not get that data until later. And so there's a number of reasons, again, when you're looking at close to 40,000 case investigations we've initiated, those are some of the reasons why one individual person might not have been connected with or might not have gotten the message, or there could have been a bad phone number written down. If that family wants to share their privately their information, we're happy to look into their specific situation. But certainly the aim and intention is to contact all, and that's what how we're structured, that's how we're staffed, that's how we're set up, and that's how we're operating.
This next question deals with a question in regards to whether there's been outbreaks at any of the casinos, and Dr. Wooten will respond.
This question is from Cliff Albert from Kogo News. Have you had any outbreaks at any of the casinos in the county? And if not, are you surprised that there have not been any so far?
Thank you for that question. As those casinos are, they operate under their own authority, under the federal government. And if there are individuals that are members of the San Diego community, we certainly do operate or investigate those cases. If they are staff, that is under the purview of the casinos. And so we work with the casinos, and to date, we have no specific outbreaks that we have reported or are reporting.
Okay, this next question is from Julie Watson at the AP. Can you talk about outbreaks in restaurants, restaurant bars being main driver of community spread? Will this mean no indoor dining or further restrictions in the near future?
Well, the rationale and reason for the restrictions from the state is because our numbers were increasing, and that is why indoor dining was restricted and moved to outdoor dining. Obviously, everyone should be aware, and as a result of our case rate decreasing below 100 per 100,000 population, that strategy worked. So again, until we get further directions from the state whether other businesses and how those businesses will open up, that guidance again will come from the state. Thank you.
This next question deals with the reopening of schools, and Gary Johnson's going to respond to the question.
This question is from Saddam Aguayo at Univision, San Diego. While schools are closed, parents have started to look for alternatives such as learning pods. Alpine School District has announced that they will be organizing learning pods when school starts next week. Are districts or schools allowed to do this, and are there any restrictions?
Thank you, and good afternoon, everyone, and a great question. We did first hear of Alpine School District's intent to basically have a plan for pods. We reached out today. I have not, myself and my team have not had the opportunity yet to review that plan, and we'll seek to do that. I can tell you that the state is looking at several options like pods, and we're expecting guidance from them hopefully in the very near future. And so at this point in time, we'll reach out to Alpine School District, take a look at what they have, work with them, and then if we have any questions or areas where we need some clarification or guidance, we'll take it straight to the state and then go from there.
Well, that completes our questions for today, but before we go, I wanted to give everyone a heads up about something really important that's going to be happening this Friday. Friday is Census Day of Action. And this is organized by United Way of San Diego and a number of other organizations collectively working as the Count Me 2020 Coalition. The Day of Action kicks off at 5:30 p.m. on Friday with a virtual rally and panel of community leaders, and between 6 and 8 p.m. caravans will begin throughout the region. We know the pandemic is in everyone's mind and certainly top priority, but it's important that we get every San Diegan to fill out their census form. By completing the census, you help fund programs that serve our community, like preschools, healthcare, emergency services, and many, many more. To be counted today, visit my2020census.gov or call 844-330-2020. That's 844-330-2020. Just a reminder that we are not scheduled to hold another media briefing until next week on Monday at 2:30. We will update the media and we will update our coronavirus website at coronavirus-sd.com. Remember, we may be off the watch list, but let's not lose sight of our goal. It's up to us if we want to keep our schools open or get our schools open and end indoor restrictions. So continue to cover your face, maintain space for others, and avoid large gatherings. Stay safe, San Diego. Protect yourself and your neighbors and friends, and protect everyone else. Thank you.